Hey, good afternoon, and a very warm welcome to yet another session of An Author's Afternoon. As you know, this session is one of the many initiatives of the Prabhakaitan Foundation in the field of literature. An Author's Afternoon is one such undertaking in which a platform is provided for the author and one of her aficionados to interact and exchange their views. We are going through some very dark and difficult times right now. So the foundation has decided to kind of lift the morale and the spirits of its patrons. So we've taken these sessions virtual so you can enjoy them in the sanctity of your home. Our guest author today is Kavita Kane. Welcome to the show, Kavita. And she is said to have revolutionized the domain of women writers in the sphere of mythological narratives. She chooses to unveil the lesser known characters from mythology, and her books have been very well received. Kavita Kane is the author of 6 very popular books: Karna's Wife, Sita's Sister, Menaka's Choice, Lanka's Princess, The Fisher Queen's Dynasty, and the latest one, Ahalya's Awakening. She quit her job as the assistant editor of Times of India to devote herself full time as an author. Kavita currently lives in Pune with her family and a retinue of 4-legged friends. Well, we have something in common there. In conversation with her today is well-known entrepreneur, social worker, a columnist with a leading daily, and a dear friend, Swati Gautam. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the session. Welcome to the show, ladies, and over to you. And just one, before I hand it over, we have a Q&A at the end of the session. So anybody who has any questions, please don't forget to press the raise your hand icon on your screen. Thank you.
Thank you, Esha. Thank you so very much, my dear. Look at all of us meeting virtually. Thanks to Prabhakaitan Foundation. Thank you, Anindita. And hi, Kavita.
Hi, Swati.
The way we'll be doing this, Kavita, you and I had a chat the other day. It's so important that all our viewers here get to know at least a little about all your 6 amazing books. So we'll touch upon each of your 6 books, and then we'll try and hope that we have some time to dig into you as an author and ask you questions that hopefully are relevant to our viewers. So as Esha mentioned, all of your 6 books. Let's start very quickly with Sita's Sister. Okay, I believe you started on Karna's Wife, but Sita's Sister was the first to be published, right?
No, Karna's Wife was the first to be published, but initially I wanted to write about Urmila, Sita is about, right. And I realized no, I couldn't because there wasn't much material on her when I started to. And that was extremely discouraging. I was wondering whether I should go on with the book or not. It was my debut book, so I was thinking, should I start writing a book? And it started off with that huge moral dilemma. And then I thought about my second most favorite character was Karna, of course. So that's how Karna's Wife came to me. And I think the success of Karna's Wife actually gave me the courage to again go back to Urmila and sort of flesh out her story, where there's absolutely nothing about her besides those 3 or 4 lines where she actually sleeps those 14 years during the exile. So I used it sort of a metaphor for the novel, and essentially because I'm not only interested in Urmila, it's not the book actually is not only about Urmila. People ask me why the book's name is Sita's Sister. I think the whole thing was about, one aspect we do not realize about the Ramayana very often is about the sisterhood in the Ramayana. And I think that book was sort of the basis of that, where it's not about the 4 sisters alone. It's about Sita, of course, it's about Sita, Urmila and the 2 cousins. But it's also about the entire concept of sisterhood, where Sita, as she meets different characters, women characters, though it's not shown very directly, it shows the empathy, the entire empowerment of women through her women relationship, or whether they are her 4 sisters, whether the whether they are the three mothers, later on the Rishi's wife, or even in Lanka, whether it's Trijata. So all these people, all these women, how they form a very subtle subtext of sisterhood in the Ramayana. I think that was what this book actually was about. I think I was planning on a part two. Let's see if the part two ever happens. But it started off on that.
I have a question here. Okay, one, Sita's sister, I mean, right in the title of the book, Urmila derives her identity from being Sita's sister.
Yes.
Okay, yet Urmila is the central character. Okay.
Correct.
Now, Urmila is portrayed in your book as the leader amongst Janak's daughters. Okay. Yes, there was the divine Sita and there was Shukriti and the rest. But so can you give us some clear illustrations, some examples of what set apart, some incidents, or what set Urmila in your eyes as a leader, as the strongest amongst Janak's daughters?
I think she was the leader because I think the very fact that she took the responsibility of the palace when the three people were not there. I mean, just imagine what life would have been if the three princes, Ram and Lakshman, not there, Sita not there, the old king has died. So it was absolutely a broken family.
Bharat and Shatrughna?
Bharat was not there. Bharat after the point. Yes. And Shatrughna, he was there. Of course.
Yes,
so Mitagirti do play a very important part in the book. So this whole thing of how she holds the family, she sort of holds the fortress. You know, so I think that of course this is all fiction. I'm not saying that she had any leadership qualities, but actually when you see a woman of a very silent strength and fortitude, you don't realize it. We only see her suffering, but I think there is a lot of courage and a sort of conviction in that. It's sort of a private exile which she also lived through. Besides that, we see the exile. We actually see the exile of the three main characters in the Ramayana. But I think Urmila, she sort of drew me to her because she's, I think, one of the most overlooked characters. We really know about her, but we really don't know the strength, the fact, what all she did. I mean, there comes an issue where she could have gone with Lakshman as his wife at the forest. But as Sita's sister and her sister-in-law, Sita also could have intervened and sort of asked her sister to accompany her. But it didn't happen. So I think these sort of, the family equation, it suddenly gives rise to that also.
Did Lakshman actually forbid her from following him?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
I think that is the critical point. Because she says, I am a slave. I am going there as I'm going to serve my brother. How can the wife of a server be there? You know, the whole logic is like that. Whatever the reason, I'm not, that's a different moral dimension in itself. But I'm trying to see the girl's point of view where, what is her life? And when, you know, she's, how quickly she grabs the situation, that shows a certain maturity. You know, she never, like we say, it is tolerance, a certain subjugation, a certain succumbing to whatever. I mean, you can call it. I think that's what I'm trying to say. When we talk about strength, we talk about, no one has to be loud and, farting at the mouth sort of a strength. It is here, she does it in a very dignified way. And she, the whole thing is of the framework is that you have to be strong within the situation you are given in.
Correct.
You know, the thing is you cannot change your situation.
Correct.
See, instead of sort of wallowing in the helplessness or the self, the whole self-pity about it, I think she tries to make a better person of herself also and her own situation.
Correct.
The fact that there are some little small threads where she said, it's mentioned that she painted through the 14 years. She finished their entire painting of the marriage, of the wedding.
Right.
So I think these sort of small stories, the folk stories also helped me a lot to sort of flesh it out. And it have not only Urmila, all the other characters. So I think Urmila comes out a woman of huge, immense strength, but in a very, she's always in the shadow. You know, the whole thing that her identity is Sita's sister or Lakshman's wife, or even, we don't even know her as Janak's daughter. And I think Janak himself being such a huge character, I mean, being a daughter of such a man, he was a Raj Rishi, a philosopher king. So she had a certain maturity and...
But you have to remember that we have to introduce them to all of your books. So you must give us what is absolutely of core importance, or they miss out on one of your books.
So I think I'll shift to the next book first. You want me to describe each book, what I feel about each book?
I'll ask you a specific aspect of the book. Otherwise, the description will be, we won't be able to go through it.
So exactly. So Sita's sister is not only Sita's sister. She's Janak's daughter. She is Lakshman's wife. So yes, she has a... and I don't think she has any qualms about it. She doesn't mind this whole thing of she is a protagonist. But yes, she is known as someone else. That itself is the irony. Her irony is that she is known as someone else. But yes, she is a character to reckon with.
See, in Karna's wife, okay? It's well known, Kavita, that Karna's wife, the first wife was Rushali, and the second wife, as we know, was known as Padmavati, also known as Supriya. But you've called her Uruvi. So there must be some basis to it. So where does Uruvi come from?
You mentioned Supriya. Supriya herself is again a fictitious character created by Shivaji Savant and Mrityunjaya in the book of Mrityunjaya. So second wife, and I mean, these are all folk stories. I sort of extracted her from the Tamil folklore. She's Ponurvi.
Correct.
So I took a sort of, and there is another story where Duryodhan's wife, she hopes, she wants Karna to marry a certain Kshatriya princess. These are all stories which I sort of stumbled upon. So I sort of just related one to the other, and I made Urvi. Urvi, as I said, right from the beginning, she is a fictitious character. And because I did not want to sort of tamper with the image of Vrishali, I really didn't want to do, because she was, being a Marathi, I have read Mrityunjaya, and in Marathi literature, it has a huge influence. And I didn't want to sort of corrupt the image of Vrishali. I didn't want to touch her.
Right.
So I said, okay, I will not make her as a protagonist. I will create another wife, because definitely it was polygamy that time. So Karna was not a person who would have only one wife. So yes, I did create her. And I think I took a very huge creative license, and I was very scared. And it was a debut book. So I was totally unsure how the book would be.
Okay.
Yes. But I think, yes.
It was wonderful. It was absolutely wonderful. Would you like to, Karna's wife, would you like to sum it up, your experience in writing, your experience in conceiving the book for our viewers here?
Yes, because I think when I took this step, you know, I really thought about it, because when I took this step, I really Uruvi was his conscience. You know, she sort of personified his conscience. Because Karna, we often say, you know, he's again painted white or black. And I was more interested in his gray. You know, he's neither a noble warrior. If he was a noble warrior, he also did a... They are very, very dark shades of him. He's almost... He can be... That's why he is with Duryodhana. You know, the whole thing of the villainy. He's sort of an anti-hero. So that is what I think the person who would best show him in his correct light would be his wife. So that wife would... of course, she would not just be his wife, his friend, his lover. She would also be his guide, his conscience, and... eventually his biggest critic. So I think that is how, right from the beginning, I thought of Uruvi, because he had to be a spirited person who would sort of tackle not only Karna, I mean someone as strong as Kunti or Bhishma also. So she had to be a person who was who had an equal political and social status. So yes, Uruvi was created on those lines, and she sort of answers the question which every reader has these questions about the Mahabharata, you know, especially where Karna is concerned. The moral questions which always arise, or this whole ethical reckoning which is there. So I think she sort of personifies all those questions which... I think that's how, it was a very, very raw way of... it was my reaction to, let's say, a Mahabharata. And as my father eventually said, you know, when I was reading the book, it was felt like you were asking those questions. Because that's what I used to, harass them with these sort of questions. So I think Uruvi just became an extension of me asking those questions. But yes, through a character whom I really, really very fondly molded.
And you're very fortunate to be in a position where you can actually ask those questions through millions of books that are published in your name, you know. You don't just have to live with those questions and keep those questions to yourself. You're a very blessed person in that sense.
Thank you. Yes, I really do, because eventually I think writing is that is a part. It's a part of a writer, of an author who wants to sort of vent out his certain, what is it, anxieties, his questions, his dilemma. Yes. And I think Karnad's wife actually encapsulated everything.
Right. Your third book, very, very interesting. What a lovely take. Menaka's Desires. Okay.
Menaka's Choice. Yeah.
Menaka's Choice, sorry. And well, you see how desires playing in the subconscious of my mind. Because she was a very desirable, the most desirable woman in heaven, the Swargapsara, and sent by Indra to break the penance, the meditation of the Brahma Rishi Vishwamitra, who in turn was wanting to create a parallel heaven. And naturally that threatened Indra. So Indra sent Menaka to break his meditation. And she succeeded. And through their union was born a baby girl, Shakuntala. Now here I'll bring into our discourse, Kavita, your thoughts that you say that Menaka voices in your book, this thing about love. Because Menaka was then, when Vishwamitra, for the benefit of our viewers, when Vishwamitra finds out that he has been, he has been cheated by Menaka, in the sense that she was sent by Indra, he then banishes her and says that, you can neither come back to your daughter, the baby girl, Shakuntala, mm-hmm. or to me, who, and she's by then very much in love with him. And she then...
He doesn't, let me just stop you.
Yes.
He does not come to know. In fact, the whole Menaka show, the title is on that. The choice is that whether she should tell him the truth or not. It was she who tells him that.
Right.
So I think that because when we're talking about the topics, we tend to slot the women characters into stereotypes. So again, either she's the Devi or she's the sort of a devil, like Surpanaka in my next book. But even the Apsaras, Apsaras are seen again in an extremely myopic way, where they're seen as these beautiful seductresses. Who sort of just seduce the rishis or whoever they are assigned to go and then go back. But each apsara, if you actually see the story, it's quite a tragic story. Especially Menaka's, because here, I'm just rushing to the sort of the denouement of the book.
Correct.
Where after everything, she sort of gets her own piece of heaven on earth after marrying, after getting Vishwamitra. She has a choice because she cannot live with the lie and the deceit. And in spite of having a daughter, she decides that she knows that everything is going to hang on. So she confesses, she tells him, and then it's up to him. She knows what he's going to be because she knows what sort of a man he is. And she realizes there's also a certain selflessness, not only her personal happiness. She realizes that being with her, he has forgotten his path. That was what the whole assignment was meant to be. So I think the reason he becomes a Brahma Rishi again is because of Menaka. So if she is the reason for his fall, she's also the reason for his success and his rise. So here, I think the Menaka which I wanted to show was a selfless woman, which we do not see Apsaras often as. Apsara who is sort of embroiled in the politics of the Devas, the whole power struggle between man and, I'm trying to... it's not about just gods and goddesses in heaven. It's about also the tussles and how the whole past struggle is transferred on earth. And Apsaras are just pawns to be used in
But that. Kavita, but, you say something which is very interesting and very relevant today for all of us. You see, Menaka says that you humans believe in the permanence of love, whereas time is impermanent. So you believe in the permanence of love despite the impermanence of time.
Yes.
So this is just so profound. So what is your take on it? You're the one who writes these words, even though Menaka says there.
Yes, because that is exactly, she's immortal. She is immortal. When she's saying in this particular point of view, she realizes that a man becomes immortal through his actions, through his acts. Love is one of the expressions of his love. So, I think when a man, when you say that whole, the memories, whatever is left behind, that makes man immortal. So, here the book was also a sort of a tussle between mortality and immortality. And what we think immortality is the ultimate heaven, which is not. Which is actually not. You're trapped in a continuous state of endlessness.
Not being, yes.
So not I being. Think Menka is caught in that trap, and she wants to let go. That's why she chooses the life on earth. And I think that way, I think after Karna's wife and Urmi, Sita's sister, this book was the first book which actually started moving towards the dark a little, and also the layers. You know, it was not a very simple story. We know of Vishwamitra, the entire seduction story, but I think it was the fact that Menka was also married. Vishwamitra was the second man in her life.
Yes.
Vishwamitra himself was married. It was not that Shakuntala was the first child she abandoned. She abandoned two daughters. So I think she had a lot of past. Yeah, she had a lot of baggage.
And the marriages were basically, the unions were marriages.
Yes.
There's nothing else to it. You were interested in a man. You were involved with the man. Your feelings with him. And you consume it with the man. And there you are. You're married.
Yes. And that the thing was, each relationship had a certain purpose, had a certain goal. And there was a reason why they were there. So I think she realizes the uselessness of the relationship at this point. And I think she withdrew. But you know, that I think she does it with so much of courage and grace. So I think definitely she did it. Because I remember that was one book which I started with a lot of, sort of hesitancy. Because again, this whole part of her sexuality, where her sexuality is a given there, where it's a part of her character. She doesn't even realize it's a weapon. It's a weapon they use. I mean, beauty and their own female. I mean, she is sort of an apsara that's supposed to be the symbol of, the ultimate symbol of female sexuality. So that again, weaving that part into the book was also very important, because I was not writing about a nun. So there were certain steamy scenes, which again, I was a little, yes, honestly, I was a little skeptical about that too, how it would, but I think, yes, it got a, it was needed. It was real.
So when you've got swarg apsaras like Menaka, you can't not have steam.
Yeah, and it was at that time when I was doing the research, I realized even seduction was such an art. It was such a science there.
Still is.
Where calm but and, you know, they used to have, and Bharat Muni through dance, like they were, I mean, it was such a studied sort of a weaponry which was used. And beautiful. I mean, when I was going through the research, I was completely engrossed. I mean, I had to really sort of wean myself out from my research and start writing.
You know, I'm going to come back at the end of all your books, quickly come back to know how exactly was your research working, or what was that methodology. Very interesting. Okay, so your next book was The Fisher Queen's Dynasty, right? Sabyavati.
Next book is Lanka's Princess.
Okay, fine, then we do Lanka's
Surpanaka
first, and then we do this, because both of them were 2017, I think.
No, it was 2013, 14, 15, 16.
Okay.
One book a year, I think. It's quite
So we come to Lanka's Princess, which is Shurpanakha. Here, for the first time, your central character is very clearly negative in the major part of her being. So she wallows in hatred, in jealousy, in envy. There's very little good in her. However much we may speak of a context that led to this negativity, there is no heroism in her where she conquers hatred by love, right? So do you really think that Shurpanakha was the cause of the fall of Lanka?
No. I don't think it was Shurpanakha at all. I think it was just Ravan and Ravan alone. Mm-hmm. Brought about not only the fall of Lanka, the fall of his entire family. It's such a tragic fall. He was he had everything. He was a self-made man. He was handsome. He was a scholar. He was a great musician. He was a scientist. Just because of his, the tragic flaw, which is called his ego, which actually brings down. He's the reason for his own downfall. So, no, I would not say. Surpanakha, these are all triggers, in the sense they are a trigger for the plot, actually. Because if Surpanakha, that the second half of the Ramayana doesn't happen at all. It's like Mantra and Kaike in the first half. She is sort of the antagonist, female antagonist of the second half. So, Surpanakha, actually, when I was writing about her, it was definitely, I did not want to paint, make her a saint into a sinner or a sinner into a saint, So didn't want to blanch her character at all. It was about just tell her story. If she has all the negativism, all this evil which is there in her. I think before she destroys anyone, she destroys herself. You know, that is what actually it does to a sort of a tormented or a tortured person. When you talk of revenge, actually the biggest injuries on you inflict is upon yourself. She mm-hmm. does, and she realizes it's too late when she loses everything. So I think it was her story. That was the moral lesson, actually. It was about where, actually, beyond the point, revenge is so futile. Because it doesn't work. There is no, even if you get, you see all the destruction around her. You see the destruction around Lanka, but still she's not. She doesn't get what she wanted. So there is no peace after revenge. And this whole, I think it's sort of a repeated theme which happens in Karna's life also. This the entire immediacy, the need for forgiveness. I think that is so necessary in times of violence. When man is basically violent, so with violence there has to be a certain forgiveness. So I think, and the more difficult part is to forgive yourself. I think, and that is what. She has to forgive herself. I think that is her journey. So Lanka's princess is basically on that a sister of three very powerful brothers, very remarkable brothers. And she is the sister, and we don't know anything beyond that point that Ashia, beyond the episode in the forest and when she goes back to Lanka, to Ravan to complain about them. But who is Surpanaka? What happens to her after the war? So I think that was, I think she as a person was, she's neither the vamp, she's neither the villain, nor is she a victim. Who was she? So I think that was what, just her story.
There are lots of questions that have emerged later about whether Ram and Lakshman should have joked around with her when she proposed to them. I mean, the way they kept saying
They did it. It is not because there again, the whole thing, it's so subtle. I mean, how beautifully does Valmiki handles it. It shows the difference in cultures. We have to realize, you know, it's instead of sitting in the judgment chair and sort of judging Surpanaka or Rama or Lakshmana or Sita or Rama, they actually show the difference in the culture of, let's say, an Ayodhya or a Mithila. Ayodhya and Kishika, Ayodhya and Lanka. So when Ram and Lakshman meets a Surpanaka, it's a cultural confrontation where they are not used to a sexually bold person, woman coming up to them. And typically, because they're awkward, they joke around. You know, they're embarrassed. That's how I think he has to hide their awkwardness. They play around with it. So I think that is, and it's such a beautiful, actually it's so deep and layered, that whole episode. And which eventually leads to her nose being chopped off, which again is one of the most violent episodes. It's more violent than the war itself, if you actually see it. And then
a man to chop a woman's nose.
Yeah, and then again, I think this whole theme of whether evil is gendered, you know, this whole somehow or the other, it comes back to the gendered.
Yeah,
a viewpoint where everything leads to that. So, I think Surpanaka is her story had to be told. I wanted to tell a story of more or less of a sort of a tormented character. Not,
did you refer to Kamban's Ramayana also while?
Yes, and that whole story of, I think that I found very interesting in the folklore, where she actually uses Ram and Lakshman to fight her war against Ravan. So where it actually turned the whole story around.
Kavita, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, but
tell me.
You, yeah.
So as a, I mean, when you research and you find two such amazingly contradictory points of view. Mm-hmm. In Kamban's Ramayana, Surpanaka is, to put it very simply,
yes,
plotting and using as plotting to use Ram and Lakshman to have her brother killed, who she has certain grievances against. But not so in Valmiki Ramayana. So these great contradictions, in short, where do you think, how do you think one can work one's way past them?
They are not just contradictions. I think that is everyone's...
Also opposing points of view.
Yeah, because, that is the beauty of both the epics. Is that the different versions which we see, they actually are progression, or they are the thoughts of, they are the perspective of that particular person, of Kamban. So for him, she was Meenakshi. She was not
correct.
Not the Surpanaka of Valmiki. And here I tried to bring the two together. I mean, she is Meenakshi, known as Meenakshi, and then how from Meenakshi she becomes Ashwathamitra.
Correct.
So I think that is the story about. But here, exactly, because these versions actually show the dynamism of the epics, the reason why they have existed for so thousands of decades, centuries rather, years, not thousands of years. So the whole thing is because of these versions, because we are allowed to think in a different way, we see right. them in a different perspective.
Right.
And that is what gives it a certain democratic, the whole viewpoint is become democratic because yes, Surpanakha from the Kamban Surpanakha is so different from the Valmiki.
Absolutely.
So different. So
she,
I think
with Kamban, she is a Meenakshi. She is the
yes, Meenakshi. Yes. That whole
she's lovely. And here we grew up reading of Surpanakha as the of that, absolutely.
And then the serial made her laugh also, yes. And that cackling laughter. Yes. Yes. So I think we sort of demonized her.
So much so that the laugh reached the hallowed halls of India's parliament.
Yes, exactly. So this is, see how much it sort of captures the imagination, the collective imagination of the power of all this.
Yes.
So I think. So I think I just wanted to show Surpanakha as a person, as a woman, not just she's been demonized. Just wanted to humanize her a little without taking the. Whatever she had done. So I was not trying to justify her. As I said earlier, I didn't want to blanch her character at all. She was not heroic in the sense with any redeemable quality. No. But I think the fact that she was like any of us, a girl of insecurity, her insecurity sort of blew up. And once the whole tragedy of loss, when she loses her husband, she loses her son, and how she turns into a vengeful woman. I think that was what Lanka's Princess was. And that is one book which I think I really enjoyed writing. I mean, that is
wonderful.
Really, really, yes.
Wonderful.
I really, because it was very emotionally exhausting because I was writing about a negative character.
Correct.
And trying to understand her and trying to humanize her actually made her, to make her the woman next door or the girl next door, you know, who is a little shy, who is a, she's feared, but she's inherently a little shy. She's sort of so unsure within, she's sort of in the shadow of her three brothers. And this sort of a girl, how she grows up into.
Right.
And
right.
her fascination, you know, her attachment to her father. And she loses her father. There's a whole abandonment issue between.
Right.
So I think, yes, they are issues which are so common in everyday living. I mean, we have. How difficult it is for a girl to grow up with a lot of complexity. So I think she was just one complex girl who led a complicated life.
Wonderful, wonderful. So we quickly move on. We stick to the topic of, we come back to the topic of love, to discussing how you are perceiving love through your characters. In your next book, which is The Fisher Queen's Dynasty, which is about Satyavati, the stepmother to Bhishma Pitama, and grandmother to Dhritarashtra and Pandu, and naturally the matriarch of that whole clan. Now, Satyavati says that I learned to love like a man, to love without feeling, and I shall never forget this lesson. Now, I see a kind of double jeopardy here, okay? Mm-hmm. One, to say that men only love without feelings, or men love without feelings. And secondly, to then reduce your womanhood, which is, of course, stronger because you love with feelings, to that of a man. So what is your quick take on this?
This line has been the most quoted line in the book.
Okay.
Actually, I read it from her personal experience. So I would not make it very generic. Here it is about she has a certain cynical view about the way her mother was treated. Satyavati's mother. See, Satyavati's story has a lot of metaphors. You know, if you actually go through the that fish, whole concept of a fish, right. And again. You know.
So
her mother was sexually assaulted. So was she with Rishi Parasara. I mean, but she sort of changed, sort of makes the situation, she uses the situation for her benefit in some way. So she has a certain, not only cynical, I don't think she has much respect for men at that particular point when she says those lines. So that, I think that comes, this line is almost on the second chapter. Third chapter. So that is because what she has gone through. I mean, that you cannot dismiss. But she never uses that as a victim card. She never, never, ever uses that. She becomes stronger with every hurdle. And if you see Satyavati, Satyavati is, I think, the most political person in the entire Mahabharata. I mean, forget a woman or a man. She's the most political person. She knows where she is. She uses politics to, whether it's family politics or whether it's politics of the court. But she uses it to for self-preservation, to strengthen her own position and the position of her sons. So she's the reason why Devrat becomes Bhishma. So this is the woman who, these particular lines where love, I don't think she loved, she never ever falls in love after. She never does fall in love. For her love, is, I think the only love she had was A, for the throne, for the power she had, and I think for her children. And that after a point also, where she uses her own sons as pawns also. So, even later, I say her daughter's in law. You know, she is as ruthless as any other person could be. So when I think it comes to power and politics, again, so you cannot say gender, I think it is not gender biased at all. It corrupts both, a man and a woman equally. So I think when Satyavati is in power, she does the same thing which otherwise she had born herself. So that it is, she is again, this whole again, her passage was from what she got, what she achieved. And till the end, she doesn't regret any of her decisions. And it's only till the, I think it's almost in the epilogue where Vyas tells her. And that is the time she realizes. Yes. And then she retreats, because physically she's there in the Mahabharata for a very, very long time. We don't actually see her, but she's there right from Shantanu's time to the death of Pandu. I mean, she's there for such a long time.
She was so much more younger than him. So she obviously was outliving.
Whole thing was, she and Bhishma must have been the same age.
Same age, contemporaries, for all you know, yes.
So I think so that whole entire arc of her, and her arc is, she as not only as a person from a fisher to a fisher girl, she becomes the queen. It's also she as a, from a girl, she becomes a woman. From a woman, she becomes a wife. But she never becomes a lover. You know, that is one aspect.
No, she shuns love.
Yes, she never becomes a lover. So that is one part, yes. So yes. It's one part missing in her puzzle as such. And yes, Satyavati was about, it was a politically strong person.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Kavita, what is your research methodology? How do you research? What all do you go through when you're building up these characters who are really secondary? They're on the sidelines, yet they are real characters. How do you research, please?
Research is, I think now it's become a pattern where I know our characters have. There's not much matter on them because they are sort of sideline minor characters. Per se, there's not much material on them. So I sort of try to draw whatever I can from the bigger characters and the events around them. So if it is Satyavati, she is sort of molding more on whatever information I could get from about Bhishma, you know, sort of gets distilled into Satyavati.
But where do you get this information? Do you read text? Do you read?
Yes, you have to. And a lot of regional. The whole thing is folklore again. Folklore is extremely illuminating because I think they are the ones which again, humanize all these characters. It's not about just, you know, sort of deify them. You know, folklore, if you see in each state, they give a certain, there's a certain enchanting humility to those characters. I think, as I said earlier in Surpanaka, that whole story about where she uses Ram and Lakshman as a revenge to, because she realizes their potential and she uses them against her personal battle against, or personal revenge against Ravan. So, you know, these stories, or even the, let's say, the sexual tension between Karna and Draupadi, of course, it's not there in the epic, it's definitely not there. This is a part of folklore. So, I think how it has been, these sort of stories which sort of enhance the whole thing. So, the research is.
So whilst your characters are real, and I totally understand and appreciate that, you know, folklore forms the bedrock of how you create your stories. So then the finer nuances, their thoughts, their expressions, their dialogues, their words are then your creation. So that bit is fictional?
Yes, completely. In fact, these books, as I said, they are fiction. The fiction is almost what, 70% or 30% is research, whatever matter is there. So it's essentially, it's the part of my 70mm screen which I'm seeing in my imagination. So I'm just translating it into black and white. But yes, it is 70%.
Okay, I have a socially relevant question to ask you, after which I think we'll have to move into our Q&A. Mm-hmm. Kavita, I'm thinking aloud. You know, there's this genre of mythological books is such a popular, wonderful, I mean, it is bringing mythology closer to the people. Okay, so whilst a lot of them, old and young, would not have been interested in mythology, they are, so apart from you, there are others who are doing, you know, it's a great thing to happen to us. However, what kind of risk do we run with the 70% fiction then being translated as mythological facts in these impressionable minds? What are your thoughts on this? I mean, people end up thinking of everything then as a mythological fact.
No, I would definitely say they're not. It cannot be a mythological fact, but for the simple thing, because they are alternative perspectives. So you have to go back to the original. So I think the reader, somehow or the other, is always been told that yes, you go back to the original and see what the original story is about. Because the very fact that I'm making Urmila my protagonist when Sita is the protagonist, that itself, that is the biggest leeway I've taken. You know, that is, so that I think the reader realizes, and I think he does go back to the original. He has to, because that is not the last, or even my latest book on Ahilya story. I mean, there's so many versions which you see of Ahilya. And I stuck to the Valmiki ones essentially because, yes, where I'm talking about fiction, but I try to stick to the original as much as possible. I do not, when I say fiction, when I flesh them out as believable and as rational as the original, because A, they are not my character. And these are borrowed characters. B, I do not want anyone to say, oh my God, she's so different from what I actually. So whether it's an Urmila or a Menaka or a Satyavati, or even an Ahilya or a Surpanaka, she is what is there. She is part of the popular imagination. So she is not drastically different. But yes, she has, when she voices, it is just that 70% fiction is the voice I'm giving her. She has a platform to voice her emotions, her experiences, her story. That's about it. The fiction, we are talking about how relevant, or I think that is what versions were about. I mean, when we talk about Shakuntala, the story of Shakuntala, which we know, is Kalidas' Shakuntala. We do not know the original story of the Mahabharata Shakuntala, where, you know, this whole story of he forgetting and the ring sounding, yes, the ring being found. No, this is all Kalidas' version of it. So I think this whole, where literature and mythology, or literature and the epics, or the Purans, they always have had a symbiotic relationship. It was always interweaved. So literature has always used these the ancient texts and the Puranas as not only a literary device, as a way of telling a story with a moral and a philosophical depth, because that is what these stories are actually about. The fact that they're still relevant today is because this essence has been carried forward. And as long as each author carries that essence and not corrupt that essence, I think it's fine.
Because you're very right, but then look at what you just said. As long as every author does it, I hope self-discipline will prevail amongst the authors. It has prevailed immensely.
But I think here, I think I respect the readers more, because I think they're quite discerning. They know the difference between fact and fiction and falsity and the sensationalism. I think they realize all that. So I think the reader is not, I think we really take underrated our reader. I think the reader knows.
Yes. Wonderful.
I think he definitely knows.
True. We have not spoken about Ahilya, okay? And she remains this most silent, this most passing by in a flash kind of a character, even though her husband is one of the Saptarishis, okay? Gautam Rishi. Where do you place Ahilya? Tell me this very straight. Was injustice meted out to her by her husband or not? What is your take?
Yes, of course. But I don't think it's wrong on his part also. Because she was, that's why I stuck to the Valmiki's Ahilya, where this whole thing becomes, Gautam is not in the wrong at all, actually, if you see. He finds his wife being unfaithful and he says, in his anger, he says a certain thing. Because the whole thing has become this thing whether she, the sexual transgression which happened, happened because of trickery and subterfuge or even an assault. All these are later versions. But here the whole thing is, his essence was that she went, she knew it was Indra and she went ahead. I think that becomes the peripheral.
So you think she knew it was Indra?
Yes, she knew it.
No, there are many, many versions.
Yes, no, but original that no. That is why I stuck to road. See, you know one thing, the original stories are always, always much more deliberating in the sense they make you think. Deliberating, they are not being judgmental. What is the reason for earlier story being a part of the Ramayana? There is a reason why the story is there. Because it, in a way, a precursor to what is going to happen to Sita. So this whole thing, I think the villain is not the husband here at all. I think the villain is actually the society because we still condemn her. This whole thing of moving her from a devoted wife to a promiscuous woman.
If she knows, it's not right. But if she doesn't know, then it's okay.
No, again, it is not right. This whole thing of right and wrong.
Correct.
That, this whole punishment of her, which we see. In fact, that is why in the original thing, he doesn't turn her to stone. She becomes, he says, the whole thing is on spiritualism, where she has to find herself. It is not about where she has the right to give her own punishment. So I think it is much more nuanced and more mature than the story which has got reduced to. It has become a very sad story of patriarchy, actually, when it is not. It's a beautiful relationship between a husband and wife, an angry husband, a disillusioned husband, and also a disappointed wife. The reason why she goes ahead is not just a moment of weakness. There is a certain reason why she goes about it. So I think Ayla's story, that is why I mean it was very difficult for me, because here exactly, the whole thing was, I was not endorsing infidelity or cheating, but neither was she a victim. The whole thing of, as a society, do we have the right to pronounce that thing? You know, the whole thing was on being judged and judgment. And I think here society actually, we as the people, easily, we still do it. I mean, without knowing what is happening, we suddenly shame the person or whatever. So I think the whole story about Ahilya is not about penalty of infidelity. It's this whole conflict between punishment and justice and judgment. I think,
and also, Kavita, it's a little ironical. You see, whilst we are actually appreciative, we look up to a Menaka who makes a choice to stay, not to stay, to marry, remarry, to abandon, not abandon. She is the woman of choice. At the same time, Ahilya is not supposed to be a woman of choice, because the question arises as to whether she was promiscuous, whether she indulged in infidelity.
Yes, we don't like that choice. No, yes. The thing is that we didn't like the choice which she made. But I think the courage or whatever her repentance or whatever you say, her strength actually lies in carrying out a choice. Her choice, from the choice when it becomes a decision, and she has the strength in her and the courage in her and the conviction in her to carry out the decision. After the consequences of the decision, I think that therein lies her strength. So she is one of the most complex characters, and which we have sadly reduced her to this mute almost. She has no voice. If you actually see her, there are three men. There's Rishi Gautam, there is Indra, and then eventually there's Lord Ram.
Her life.
So there are three men, and where is her voice? Where is she? So I think she is, that is what Ahilya was about, where each one, here it was not about checking whether or even telling them whether Rishi Gautam was wrong or whether Indra was wrong. Because Indra was wrong. This whole thing is about the tempestuousness of lust, love, desire. I mean, it is part of our, not only about our, it's part of a human emotion and experience, part of the suffering. So there is going to be an ethical reckoning after that.
Right.
So I think it has to be an ethical reckoning by the character herself, not a moral judgment by others.
By the external.
That is very important. That is important. So So I think Ahilya story sort of balances on that. And yes, one of the most difficult books again was it was really difficult because it's so easy. It's so very easy to judge a person. And I think that is what mythology. That is what art depicts. That is what they all really tell is that it makes you think. Supposed to make you think, make you rationalize, not make you judge. You know, so we judge very easily and very often very wrongly. So I think Ahilya is just sort of a lesson. It's sort of a silent reprimand to us that yes, think before you say something.
Well, Kavita, you see, we've actually in discussing your 6 books. We've actually run through our entire spectrum of time. I don't think we have time for Q&As now. So I'd like to hand it over back to Asia.
Yeah, because I think 6 books by the time you need to take 5 minutes.
Well, I'm glad. I have absolutely no regret. They should have known your entire spectrum of work. What a wonderful spectrum. So over to you, Asia.
Yes, thank you so much. Yes, it was a wonderful session. Very insightful, very informative. Thank you so much. I'm not too sure if we have any questions. I can't see any in the chat box. I'll just ask Anindita. Any questions, Anindita? I think everybody was so just absorbing it all in. Very little scope for asking.
Because I think I answered whatever question they had.
Yes, you actually did. Actually, you did. You know, it was really informative and very interesting. Thank you so much, ladies.
Thank you. Let me thank each one of you all, and the Prabhakaratan Foundation, and thank you, Swati. It was. I mean, I really loved it. And yes, you gave me a chance to discuss all my 6 books. And yes, I have also a dry throat after this. But anyway, I think I explained myself. I think I must have explained myself nice and long.
Very well.
Thank you again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. And I'll just take this opportunity to thank, of course, Prabhakaratan Foundation and our sponsors, Sri Cements and Taj Bengal Kolkata. Thank you. And we look forward to seeing you at the next session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.